This is plain, ordinary, wishful dreaming.
I'm Alex Orbison, Roy Orbison's youngest son. Along with my brothers, Roy Jr. and Wesley, we're here to tell you our family story. It's a dramatic and emotional story that we still find difficult to tell. Sometimes I know that I'm getting emotional and I want to veer away, but I realize it's just best to let the emotions fly free. Pretty woman, stop a while. They say that time makes it better, but you know, that's one of the biggest lies. Time doesn't make it better, it just, time stops. Not like you think about it every day, all day, but it's really just there. And then when you visit it, it's just as fresh as it was when it happened. Be mine now. Our story starts in the spring of 1966. My dad's star was shining at its brightest. He'd had a string of top 10 hits around the world, was married to his childhood sweetheart, Claudette, and together they lived in Nashville with their sons, Roy DeWayne, Anthony King, and their new baby, Wesley.
I remember things and terms of roughly years where big events in my life happened. They started in 65 with being born. It was the biggest event. Then a year later, we lost my mother, Claudette, in a motorcycle accident, 66.
Claudette and I went riding on motorcycles. We were about 6 miles from home. I made a stoplight and turned left and then stopped. And she wasn't behind me. So I turned around and went back, and a pickup truck had pulled out in front of her. So I came home and had to tell the children, told the oldest boy that his mother wasn't coming home.
I don't know much at all about her, other than they say that she was very sweet and a pretty woman. But I was always keen to ask my father, for instance, and he would say, that's a little hard for me to talk about with you because you favor her so much, you know, you remind me of her. So I don't mind talking about it, but just give me a minute, you know.
Most of my love just, you know, went to the children. My world sort of centered around them. I didn't stop working or anything. Working is good, it's very therapeutic.
Right now, it's top of the bill time, and we have just about America's most favorite visitor to our charts. I mean, the one and only Roy Orbison!
What I did was I'd go through the motions of doing whatever I normally did. I don't think you should analyze anything immediately after it happens. And I think you need to reflect just a little bit.
A candy-colored clown they call the Sandman tiptoes to my room every night just to sprinkle stardust and to whisper, go to sleep. Everything is all right. I close my eyes, then I drift away into the the magic night, I softly say a silent prayer.
And I was touring England in 68. And I had one more show to do, which was in Bournemouth, I think, but it was on a Sunday. One of my best friends came to the room, and all he said was that, he said, your house has burned, and he said, you lost Roy and Tony.
68, we had a house fire, and I lost my two older brothers, Roy DeWayne and Anthony King. I remember wanting to go back with all my might, and Papa stuck his hand on the top of my head and kept me from physically looking back as we traveled to the neighbor's house for shelter, you know.
The house blew up. There was an explosion. And my mother and father and little Wesley were blown outside in the yard, and the other two children back into the house.
Both my hands were big, clear blisters. They looked like softballs. And I don't know if it was like a self-defense sort of thing, but yeah, my hands, they still are kind of shiny and hairless from those scars.
In dreams I walk with you. In dreams I talk to you.
There was a moment there where I have a clear memory of leaving from the fire, but not before and not for days after, other than the fact that we lived in a motel for about 6 months. There was a pool there, so that was good, but we had to kind of stay indoors a lot. And that got old really fast, and I was looking for a yard to play in, and they wouldn't let me go outside, you know, for, I guess, obvious reasons. I sure didn't understand it at the time.
Mother about things, and she would explain to me. She said, son, give it a couple of years and you'll feel a little better. And 2 years to the day, almost to the day, she was right. I was doing a tour of England in 1968. I met Barbara, and she said she had never heard of me, and I didn't believe that. And then she told me a lot of things, and I didn't believe her.
Roy saw me across the room and wanted to meet me, so the energy first came from him.
Yes.
And I didn't even know when I first started talking to him that there was any interest from him, except just a casual meeting.
Yes.
And we just started talking and really, really had something to talk about. I don't know.
Anyway, she said, that's a terrible-looking jacket you have on. I said, thank you very much. It was a Levi jacket, but I said, I just borrowed this so I wouldn't catch cold. It belongs to my friend there. And I said, come to the show tomorrow night and I'll show you my finest suit. She came to the show and she said, you know, if you were trying to impress me, you did all right. And then we were married in 1969.
My family didn't even know for the first 3 months
really?
Or 2 months. No, I was 17 and I don't think it would have gone over very well for me to have come home and said that I fell in love with a rock and roller that was like 15 years older than me.
Yes.
So I had to hide it.
Sweet dream, baby. Sweet dream, baby. How long must I dream?
So after the home burned, we needed a place to stay. Dad was building a big old beautiful home for his new wife, and he would be out surveying the progress, and it was a custom home, so it took a little longer than usual, and it turned out really terrific.
The house was fantastic. It was really like a time capsule of what you'd imagine a rock star in 1969 building. The back overlooked the lake, and it was several acres of land, and each floor had a fantastic deck that would look out. And you could tell that it was, you know, just the layout of it was a sanctuary for my dad.
My mom left her family, her home in Germany, and her language.
She gave birth to me when she was 19. So she gave up everything she was and had been for him and created a new life. Because he lost the other two boys, he was very afraid. My mom said that while she was pregnant with me, that Roy was very apprehensive, you know, almost afraid to have another child, that for the, what could happen. So he was very conflicted about that. And I definitely got a lot of the love that was meant for the two brothers that died. And so I'm aware, I was the golden boy that saved Roy's life. I was the energy that saved his life.
The Orbison household was divided into two houses. And so with Mamaw and Papaw and Wesley down the street.
Their house was just over the hill. It's really close, but you can't see it over the horizon. But it's probably about a city block is as far away. Orby Lee, Dad's father, he and Nadine together, they raised me, and that's where I grew up under their care.
From their point of view, they felt to blame that they had let Roy's children die, and they felt they let him down so much. And so my grandmother in particular grabbed a hold of Wesley and never let go. She became like the mama alligator protecting the eggs.
It didn't seem like that I was supposed to go with them. It felt like that I was supposed to stay where I was, you know? It already felt like home.
From 68 to 75, that little period was very protected. When the family got a little bit bigger and he had Alex, it started to be fun again.
So the little boys are around, you know, things are really great because they're so vibrant and full of life. So those guys, you know, would often come together to visit with their grandparents, you know, and myself. Just a glorious time. They seemed like they wanted to stay there even when it was time to go home for dinner or something like that. You know, it was always a sad time for them to have to go back home.
How are you, huh?
Fine.
Fine? How was your day?
Fine.
You got a kiss for you, Daddy?
Yeah.
Mom, I think this is probably a work of art by Alex.
Oh, it's my house.
And there we go. This is my house by Alex.
My dad had an incredible life. He was born in 1936. And when you look at history, 1936 was the dead bottom of the Depression. The crash was 29. And then they had also over farms and it made the Dust Bowl. And my dad was born and lived in West Texas. And so this would have been the driest, dustiest, hardest hit area of the Depression. And the fact that my grandparents even had a son then, and this blackness, and that this guy grew up to be this legendary character is stunning to me.
Yeah, just dropped in. How you doing there?
Fine, doing fine.
This is Dad. This is Pepper.
Yeah, this is the head man around here.
That's right, the number one.
Pepper was a guitar player and a great singer, and he was also Roy's road manager for many years until his retirement.
At a certain point, Roy was making more per night than Papaw made in a year, and so Papaw quit his job in the oil fields and working on cars and followed Roy around.
You know, my dad was super engaging in the things that he knew, and it was amazing that he seemed to be good at everything. And whatever random thing I was into, he would, you know, come either out of his bedroom or back from being on the road or whatever, and I would think I had developed some new tricks, and he was like, oh, let me see what you're doing there. And then, of course, he already had it mastered.
He did so many things so well, and he was so blessed. I don't know how he crammed so much experience into a life so short, 52 years. When did he have time to become such a good driver, such a good painter, such a good pool player? How did he know about art in Europe and the Louvre in France and Jean-Paul Sartre?
Being his son that only got limited kind of visitation, he also had this intuition. He could look at you and say, you know, I'm sorry, I've been gone or whatever, but always remember that I love you, you know, and you're on my mind all the time, you know. And it just kind of, you know, made everything better just knowing that he was carrying a little part of you with him, you know.
When you're in the middle of it, the amazing thing is how ordinary hanging out at the house seemed to me, because I never knew anything else. And so, you know, you look over and there's Dad passed out in a lounger chair, except Dad is Roy Orbison. And he's this legendary character who you never imagine just suntanning and sitting around and having a life.
We were the only people besides Elvis and Johnny Cash that had a satellite dish. We had motorcycles, go-karts, whatever kind of fad came along in the 70s. We had a kiddie pool, and when we changed it to a permanent pool, we were left with all these pipes, and we would use those pipes to shoot bottle rockets at the boats that passed by. And Alex and I were out there shooting at the boats. Dad came out, and we thought he was going to be mad at us, and he snuck down behind us and started shooting bottle rockets at the boats, too.
He always had attached to him this kind of this sad man of rock and roll, or the tragic man of rock and roll. But if you ask anybody that was around Roy for more than 10 minutes, they always remember the humor and that laugh.
Hey, man, your cat was a real pizzette who was very rarely stable. I dagger was a boozy bagger who could take you under the table. David Hume could out-consume Schopenhauer and Hegel. And Wittgenstein was a beery swine who was just a schmaltish Schlegel.
Seeing him do Monty Python skits with Roy is like the funniest thing you've ever seen. They really, you know, really nailed it down. You can see.
Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure now, and it has done for many years, to introduce a young man who's become quite a personal friend of mine, and I do mean that. Roy Orbison!
Just running scared, each place we go. So afraid that he might show.
We couldn't go anywhere or do anything ever. We had to have bodyguards and our dogs, we went through 13 dogs. They would be stolen by the fans. So you couldn't blink, you couldn't walk into an airport without everything stopping, complete silence. And We got to do certain things. We got to go to Disneyland. They closed it down for Michael Jackson, and then they closed it down for Roy. We were the next ones. Michael Jackson got a private kind of tour. They kept it open. And they did that for us when I was little.
Ta-da!
It was fully operational for 2 hours, and we got to run around. So you couldn't feel more special than that.
Menacing.
But I thought everyone was like that. That's that if your dad was a plumber, he was king of the plumbers, and all the other plumbers would come to see you. I didn't understand the mathematics that there could only be one Roy Orbison.
Well, this is the old writing couch. I'd like to get rid of it.
two of them. I've worn the thing down so it has a nice comfy spot in it. So I'm sitting for hours and hours and doing no good. I don't normally sit around and sing for anybody. There's a reason for that. I'm basically an introvert. And also, I never give a performance except in the studio when we make the record. In recent years, had accepted the fact that a man should be able to cry when he wants to cry. And that didn't bother me professionally, and evidently it didn't bother me at all, but that's why if I seem a little nervous when I play in the writing room, it's because I'm not alone. And these songs are such a part of me that you're aware of everything and everything around you. I was all right for a while. I could smile for a while. But I saw you last night. You held my hand so tight as you stopped to say hello. You wished me well. You couldn't tell that I've been crying. Like that. So, still nervous. But
people always said, Roy, you wrote these sad songs. You must be this sad guy. And, you know, it would seem like the tragedies would happen and then you'd write crying or it's over. But truthfully, my dad wrote those songs when he was in a much better place. And after the tragedies happened, that put my dad at a disconnect with his songwriting craft.
So you have to back off just enough when you're performing, or you'll get too involved and you'll break down. And if you're crying, you can't sing. You know, it doesn't work that way.
If you're crying, you can't sing crying.
If you're crying, you can't sing crying. So you just back off just a little bit, and then give it all you got.
In the middle of the 70s, it puts Roy alone in the middle of a world that had changed so far from what he knew. And the hope of getting the new songs that he would write in front of people and getting the reaction that he had always got had totally withered away. All of that happening, you know, that puts you around the time that I'm born with him very happy that his present family is flourishing. But outside that, everything had fallen apart.
Excuse me, Mr. Orpington.
Yes?
Why do you wear your sunglasses when it's not sunny?
Same reason you wear your hat when it's not raining. We'd like to do the new record for you. It goes like this. Okay?
I was spreading myself too thin. I was making too many records and I was doing too much touring.
Black woman sings and plays piano like a dream.
It's so funny because people say, oh, well, Roy didn't do so well in the 70s. You know, he was off the map and his records weren't selling. His new records didn't sell as well as his old records, but the guy literally had sold millions of his greatest hits records and was one of the highest paid entertainers.
Discover all the spine-tingling immortal songs of the most dynamic voice in the history of popular music.
He really didn't have to prove himself for anything because, you know, as a young man, he had done exactly what he wanted to do. So we just had a great time.
My dad was this car guy. I mean, every kind of car you could imagine. You know, Ford T-Birds, Corvettes, Cadillacs, Excaliburs. There's a car we still can't figure out the name of it. And literally, you look in our driveway and there's a fire truck from 1925.
If I'm to be of any value to my family, I have to be sort of selfish and write my songs and go tour. And earn a living, else they're not provided for.
Nothing you can do on tour except travel.
land, sea, or air, one way or the other, and that's always a bind. If you're in a bus or an airplane and you play cards or something like that.
You know, I listen to Dad's records a lot. That's how I visited with him. And I always really loved his voice and those recordings. They had a really terrific receiver that we had salvaged from the house fire and had a terrific sound to it. And so I would have favorites that I would play like really a lot, maybe obsessively, listening to the nuances of his voice and singing along a little bit, you know.
You're running scared, afraid to lose. If he came back, which one would you choose? Then all at once, he was standing there.
In my case, when you see me perform, what happens is I sing and the audience watches me do that. I remember when I first played a nightclub in England, I had just done concerts and then I was asked to do this very famous nightclub. And everyone said, what are you going to do, you know? And I said, I'm going to sing. So that's about all I really do is sing a few songs.
My dad hung out in that place where your voice breaks. If you listen to Only the Lonely and Crying, those lines, the place where every man wants to stay away from, it's where your voice goes, ah! It's where your voice cracks.
You gotta take if you're lonely.
That's where Roy Orbison lived. That was his stronghold. Where, like, the most sensitive, bare place, that's where he displayed his power. And he hung out on places that were, like, embarrassing for people vocally.
I started singing this way because I was writing songs. And I wrote the melody that I heard in my head, and so then I had to sing those notes as well. And I didn't know how high or low you were supposed to go, so I went where I wanted to.
There was a show in Memphis that Dad went to, probably in the 70s, and Elvis called him out in the audience and, you know, said that it was his good friend was here and the greatest singer in the world, and introduced Roy Orbison.
The first show I ever did in Memphis, my record was number one, and Elvis came along and was introduced at intermission. Of course, he stole the show, but we had a chat afterwards. And from then until his death, we were very, very close.
When Elvis died, some of the fans stole his body, and Roy started to get his gun and started thinking, and I could see he was thinking something, and what he was thinking is that there was only two directions these guys could have gone in that car, and he knew that if they went east, they would be driving through Nashville, and he was gonna get his car and go wait on the highway because they had shown what the station wagon probably looked like. He thought he could go out there and get Elvis from these people. And he was gonna do it.
I'm gonna try to remain innocent and very, very young as long as I can. But those reminders, like with Elvis and John, I've known all these people and we were very close. So that hurts a great deal. And is a reminder, even when you want to try to stay young.
So here we go, 78. My father has a massive heart attack, triple bypass surgery. You know, are we gonna lose him? And just really unexpected, you know, he's 42, gosh. And now it's more fragile than before. I always thought, you know, maybe when he retires, you know, maybe in those retirement years we would get to be closer and he would have more time and I could be more more handy for him, you know, instead of a little needy kid. I could, you know, be an adult and we could do adult things. But now some of this was in jeopardy.
I think the little one's coming pretty soon. Yeah.
So you'd rather not be smoking on camera, though?
No, if we get something that you really love, though, and I've got a cigarette in my mouth all the time, you know, that's not going to fit in well when I explain to people that I've had open heart surgery, you know. They can say, well, you know, you've got a death wish or something, you know, and they get the wrong impression.
My dad had his first heart attack in 77, 78. That puts my mom where, besides having kids, she'd never done anything with her life. And with the vulnerability of the heart attack and being at home for longer periods of time, you know, my mom had started to cope more with that, with drinking. And so she had started drinking a little bit more, and I think it played into her insecurities, and she became agoraphobic, where leaving the house at all seemed terrifying to her. For me, what was normal no longer was normal. You know, it changed. There was a seismic shift in the home life in our house. And so that can all be terrifying for a young child.
Hey, hound dog man, where you been now? Where you been? I wish that you were back. It was too good to ever end. Once in a while, someone like you.
When Austin City Limits was filmed, that guy was my best friend.
Hey, hound dog man.
The way his voice had a sort of vulnerability, and the vibrato was different than in early. It wasn't quite as confident as the early years. And wasn't quite as mature as it was in the later years. It's very vulnerable.
Gave the world a whole lot of joy.
On the Austin City Limits concert, there was one song that he didn't record anywhere else. It wasn't taped. And so that we have film of Hound Dog Man.
The way you sang, rock and roll and blues.
Hound Dog Man is the best Elvis tribute song there is. It's just so beautiful, and it's there on that video.
Memory, let it bring. Hey, hound dog man, my old friend, play it again.
Time is very important. A lot of brilliant people through the ages have written that time is the most important thing. But if you take that literally, you get very paranoid and say, I might not be around tomorrow. I'd better hurry up today and do everything I'm going to do today.
When it came time for my dad to want to reclaim his throne, because there was a time when the record industry had changed and we had had record deals and publishing deals go sour, and my dad consciously just said, I'm not playing that game because I tour, I'm Roy Orbison, I make enough money to have a happy life, and I don't like disco music anyway. And a lot of things happened around 1984. And my dad started to want to make a run for the top again. And this very much involved my mom becoming his manager and them seeing this thing through together.
Roy was signed to Virgin Records, and all of a sudden, by meeting with me, they just said, listen, you need to help us. You need to manage Roy. So that's the way it came about. Mm-hmm. Because I had a vision and they had the same vision, and it was just magic, you know?
In a way, my dad was a man with a plan, before my mom quit drinking. And then having Barbara totally on board and moving into a management role officially, Barbara finds her voice as a human being. And together they push through and the plan is working.
When you're young and you walk into to a life that is so big,
yeah,
you lose yourself. But then when it was time for me to sort of understand who I was and what I wanted to do with my life, luckily it happened that Roy could really hear me to give me that place.
Moving to California was another bold move. You know, Roy sold the house that we'd lived in for 30 years. I still look back and I go like, oh, I don't know why we sold the house, but this was a real, real break.
The strange thing about California was that my parents went to California for a writing session, and I'm 10 years old, and they went in the last couple weeks of summer, and they never came back. And so I started school in the fifth grade with no parents at home. I mean, I was like, get myself ready and go down and have the driver drive to school. Then there was a phone call. My mom and dad said, well, we're in Malibu and we love it here. What would you say if we said, do you want to move to Malibu? And I literally just screamed out loud and I was, you know, I couldn't believe what was happening. I mean, it sounded like a dream.
So now we have the family moving to Malibu. Mama was already bedridden by this point. She had crushed one of her hips and had to have reconstructive surgery. And so we couldn't make the move.
We started hanging out with you two and David Lynch and T-Bone Burnett and Jeff Lynne. And from those projects, we had the Wilburys, we had the Mystery Girl album, and we had the Black and White Night with Bruce Springsteen.
And then you go,
sweet dream. You might want to go on, mate.
Yeah, I may have to. Baby. Yeah.
After four
all
of those.
After four of those. So we do the first breakdown.
Yeah.
I'm a bit overwhelmed. I'm very grateful that all these wonderful people came by and to help me out.
The amazing thing is that this isn't a granted that Roy Orbison's actually going to have a comeback. And the fact that everything started to click and you have these crazy things like the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
In 75, we went into the studio to make Born to Run. I wanted to make a record with words like Bob Dylan that sounded like Phil Spector. But most of all, I wanted to sing like Roy Orbison. Now everybody knows that nobody sings like Roy Orbison. So all I want to say is congratulations. Thanks for the inspiration, and mercy.
David Lynch used In Dreams in a movie.
In dreams, I walk with you.
There's nothing cooler in pop history for teenagers and adults alike than David Lynch to feature In Dreams in a movie. I mean, it was so shocking and crazy and different, and it changed the pop culture where all of a sudden everyone, and literally everyone, wanted a piece of my dad, you know, just like young teenage girls trying to mob him to get his signature, and so Roy's on top of the world again.
California blue, California blue.
Roy was working with Jeff Lynne in the studio. And Tom Petty and George came to America to cut a song for his album. And they phoned Bob, and there they were.
and batted around.
In May of that year, he had called for my birthday, and they were in the studio. He says, I've got somebody that I want to have wish you happy birthday. And get on the phone, LOS, happy birthday. Next guy sounds like he's imitating the first guy. LOS, happy birthday. And he starts cracking up. By the time the third guy's on the phone, they're laughing so hard that they can't even talk anymore. And then, happy birthday to you, you know. And so Dad gets on the phone just giggling. Oh, man, that was Tom Petty, Jeff Lynne, George Harrison. And I'm like, oh, my goodness, these are some of my terrific heroes, you know. These are rock and rollers. You know, this is a band? Are you kidding? That's like the coolest thing I've ever heard.
The Wilburys weren't the saving grace that just, you know, my dad was at zero and pulled him out. Everything in my dad's life was already working. And as a result of that, the Wilburys happened. And my dad's at top form.
Won't you show me that you really care? Got somebody to lean on. Put your body next to mine and dream on.
He was able to orchestrate this high note that we get from some of his songs. You know, this is like the sad songs happened before the tragedies, and then the Renaissance happened before the end of the song, you know.
So Roy Orbison is alive and kicking, as they say in English.
Alive and well, and I guess I've never been busier or more successful. It's amazing.
Are you happy?
Very, very happy, yeah.
Roy and I had been in Europe for just a pleasure trip, and we said goodbye in England, and he was going to fly to tour one more night in Boston and Akron, I guess two more nights, and go home to Nashville to wish his mom and our other kid, Wesley, Merry Christmas. And then we were going to join and spend Christmas somewhere else.
When he comes to the house for the visit, he's real excited about the new project and
got a little time to hang out with you, man, just me and you. And I've got the new record.
Things are really going great, you know, for about an hour. Then he's unresponsive in the bathroom. Didn't want to check on him, but I had this sense something didn't feel right. I mean, it really didn't feel right. What could be wrong, you know? Hey, Dad, you know, no answer. I was like, okay. Hey, Dad, no answer. So I had to run get a phone, and I was too freaked out.
They phoned in the middle of the night, and they woke me up in the middle of the night. And then my mom just told me pretty quickly in one sentence. There was no beating around the bush, just like everybody. It's always so abrupt. There's no real way to say it. So she said, Roy Kelton. Let me see. So you can't. She said, I don't even know how she said it. She said, Roy Kelton, your dad died last night.
I was all right for a while. I could smile for a while. Say hello. Oh, you wish me well. You couldn't tell.
You can't describe what it's like to lose someone that special and so quickly. And so, you know, it was earth-shattering for me as a son.
And then something kind of beautiful happened that night because my mom was far away and the press was attacking so much. The record company Virgin And all the record companies, they are limousines to form a wall down the street so the press couldn't get there. So they blocked off the whole street with 30 or 40 long limousines. So we had a wall of limousines protecting us from the press. And then my mom got the next flight out and she flew and came to be with us.
Getting to hear the record was a little less than happy news. It was kind of, you know, this heavy, heavy bit of music that was new, but it was also kind of an end as well. This was all the new music he was gonna do. This was kind of maybe a gift, if you will. So I didn't get to listen to it with him. It took a couple of days for the dust to settle. Then I put it on, and of course the first track is You Got It. And man, oh man. Gosh, it was, you know, just so wonderful to hear how good.
I see the home videos, the one thing that really drives home is we were so loved. And like, you know, there's a little footage of my dad following me over to the beach and he's videotaping and he's trying to get a candid shot of me. So I want to jump up and down and do all the stuff. And then there's one chance that he gets when I'm looking at the waves and he's filming me. And it's all there in one moment. It's really, you know, because I felt loved and I do feel loved, but it's been a long time. And you forget a little bit.
For 20 years we were together, and at the time when he passed away, we had found a way of living where we concluded each day with one another.
Yes.
So there was not that lots of regrets. There
yes.
weren't any. And I always said that I told Roy everything that I needed to tell him during those 20 years, you know, whether I loved him or what I didn't like about
yes.
him. And we laughed lots. So there was a sense, there was a feeling of completeness when he
Absolutely.
Passed away.
Absolutely.
Which kind of helps with the grief, you know?
Absolutely.
And I have incredible boys.
Yes.
And I feel more sad for them because, you know, I don't think they got to conclude because they were 13 and 18
Absolutely.
And 22.
After my dad had died, we looked at photos and laid them all over the floor. And so they had all these wedding pictures, and it was probably the first time in my life I'd ever thought about someone other than myself. And I just thought, holy shit, you know, holy crap, what my mom is going through at this time. And then, you know, these things keep happening, the Grammy for A Pretty Woman.
Roy Orbison.
I know it was one of the great honors of Barbara's life to accept the Grammy Award on Roy's behalf in 1991. I was there too. I got up on stage and stood just a little to the right. And every achievement was another milestone. It was kind of like that part was a game. That was the game.
And Mom had accepted Dad into the Songwriters Hall of Fame.
This is truly an honor to be here tonight and accept this award on behalf of Roy. The songwriter.
Her first thought was probably that there was an outtake of Careless Hearts.
and she started looking for this outtake of Careless Hearts, and she realized that there were enough outtakes that she could make a great album.
I didn't even know if I wanted to finish this album. And I arrived at the studio, and everybody had gone, and just Don and the engineer were at the studio. And I looked around, and it was very quiet. And at that moment, you know, Don turned on the controls, and I heard the words that Roy was singing, "Reach out and let it touch your soul." And I don't know what happened to me. I knew that the album would be all right without Roy actually checking every little detail.
For us as a family, my mom was going to live forever. You know, she was she was just a tank. And she was so, you know, when she pursued something, she pursued it so wholeheartedly, and she would just get the answer that she wanted a lot of times. And so you see Roy Orbison in these amazing places. And yeah, he's the most incredible singer ever known to man, but a lot of those situations were just because Barbara wouldn't take no for an answer. And so, you know, people don't know, because my mom didn't tell anyone that she was sick, but she died super unexpectedly. Like, the same thing happens again. You know, we think that we're getting her out of the hospital, and we're not.
Golden days before they end, whisper secrets to the wind. Your baby won't be near you anymore.
The first time that Wesley and Roy and I had actually seen each other, we were just so happy to be alive and to love each other as brothers. And so the obvious thing would be to carry the torch and to do what our family has done since, you know, 1944.
She had, you know, five or six big things that we had worked on for 20 years, things that my dad had worked on and not quite completed. So she felt this obligation to him to make sure that this man's great works were completed. And now we have the same obligation to her.
There was a really dark time after Barbara had died where literally everyone was wondering, are these guys going to pull this off? And everything you could see, there was just like, and slowly but surely, I think that we've been doing well.
So, guys, should we play that tape back?
Yeah, yeah.
It sounded great, yeah. I thought. You know,
things are really going good for us. And it's wonderful to be working with my brothers, telling the story and expanding the legacy, you know, having children and being a family together. The latest project with the Royal Philharmonic is another one I'm really, really proud of. We got to play with the orchestra and be with my brothers, you know. It's really terrific.
With the Royal Philharmonic project, the sessions were so amazing. I mean, we're talking number two room at Abbey Road, that's the Beatles room. And then in Nashville, Wesley Roy and I got together at the studio that my dad owned when I was born. This is the place that my dad would have spent the most other time besides at home playing with us kids. And so here we are, 40 years later, all together. But in the middle of all of this, baby Roy had a suit that looked similar to this. It was like a little vest or something, you know. The kid is so talented at keeping time and clapping. We need to have him on the record. And so Papa Roy, in this case, which is Roy Orbison Jr., gets guitar and puts it on the floor, and the guitar is perfectly tuned, and Baby Roy strums the guitar. And it's the first thing that you hear on Oh Pretty Woman. And so you have these like three generations of Orbison men, and you have all three Roys on this one recording, and it's a surreal feeling.
My dad would say, I love you, and I would say, I love you too. One time he told me really seriously, he said, son, you'll never know how much I love you. That's a tough one. So he said, son, you'll never know how much I love you until you have a son of your own. And I didn't fully realize what he meant until I saw little baby Roy playing music on this Royal Philharmonic song, Pretty Woman. And it was like a chain of lightning that, you know, I felt that that's that torch we're talking about, that's that music. I felt that chain of lightning going through me as I looked at him. And through that, I know what he would have seen by Alex and Wesley and I playing on this this album. He would have shed a tear over that, for sure.
There goes my baby. And there goes my heart.
He was just really a terrific person to have known. Those of us who were lucky enough to love him, we really got something special, you know.
We experienced life through the prism of those songs. They were the lessons that we learned about relationships and love and heartbreak. They're the soundtrack to our lives. And we ended up living the sadness in those songs.
It's crazy to find your real calling later in life. And, you know, I'm a drummer by trade, but looking after my dad and my brothers is my true calling.
Maybe tomorrow.
They always ask him, so Roy, how would you like to be remembered? And he would just say, I would just like to be remembered.
You're gonna take a little lonely, a heartbreak, only the lonely.
NTR, speciaal voor iedereen.